Let us talk about the concept of envisioning change. What kind of change did you have in mind that you thought you'd bring to the people of Gulu by becoming their chairman?
Change has to start from yourself. I am a lawyer. I went to very good schools, one of which you also attended, Namiliango College. I went to Makerere, one of the best universities in Africa. I later went on to Yale University. It's unusual for someone with my kind of qualifications to leave the city and go to a more rural setting. But mark you, this is not the first time I had done such a thing. Upon graduating from law school and upon finishing my postgraduate studies, I practiced law for only 2 years in Kampala, then went to Gulu to set up the first ever legal aid project. I knew that our people needed legal services, but they could not afford those legal services. Now, when I came back to Kampala to serve as a member of parliament, I felt as if I was taking a break from my legal aid work. So, in a way, I just returned back home to Gulu. I see that I started to change from within, to decide that no task is beneath me, to change my attitude that it is possible for me to mix with the villagers. That is the first change. But on going to Gulu, I needed to be an advocate who could not be challenged. It did not matter whether I was talking to the World Bank, to the UN, or to the Uganda government. I needed to speak with authority. So, to bring change, you must have the authority of experience. Commitment is not enough. You must have authority. Otherwise, you cannot bring change.
Thank you. Now, I would like us to go to the second part of this interview, initiating change. Talk to me about the strategies that you had in mind. What kind of strategy did you rely on to ignite a change process?
First, I had to win an election in a much bigger area. Remember that my constituency, though highly populated, is geographically very small, the municipality of Gulu. This time, I was going to campaign in a much larger area to become chairman of Gulu District. Gulu District is half the size of Belgium or half the size of Rwanda. I needed to raise the resources. That means I had to resurrect the old networks. There is a saying that you can't launch a missile from a canoe. You must have a solid base from which you launch your missile. From a canoe, the backfire alone will sink you. So I needed to rebuild my network. I needed to run a strong campaign. And my opponent was being backed by the government. He, now deceased, was a decorated soldier. He had been chairman of Gulu for 10 years. So the first change was getting into office. Having gotten into office, I now needed to move from the politics of winning an election to the politics of governing. And Gulu presented a test for me because the same gentleman I had defeated was appointed to be the representative of the president in Gulu District. Secondly, my own party, the Democratic Party, only had 2 members in the council, which had 31 members. I needed to learn how to build bridges. So, the way to mobilize for change is to keep the collective vision in focus. But also, having won the election with over 80%, I knew I had the popular mandate. So, when I was cornered by the politics of the council chamber, my resort was to the people. The Americans call it the bully pulpit. I kept people together using a vision which they knew was not mine, but was rather collective.
And did people readily take to your to the initiative that you proposed to cause change in a case like that? Or was there opposition from some quarters?
As a leader, you can get lucky also. I think I became chairman of Gulu at the right time. The government was tired of the war. I think even the rebels found that they could not push out the government. The people also needed someone with some fresh initiatives. The fact that I was new on the block, I didn't have any political baggage, equipped me with the unusual ability to be able to speak to everyone, but not everybody shared my vision. Some of the local people thought President Museveni should be fought. In fact, some of the people thought the rebels were right. Others thought there should be no talking at all to the rebels because the rebels had committed enormous atrocities. But patience is the greatest virtue in a leader. You must keep your eye on the prize. I wanted peace through dialogue. I wanted the displaced people to go home. I wanted a new future for the lost generation that had been abducted. I wanted the restoration of the social infrastructure. These were my clear goals. So I could pay any price.
And talk to me about the attitude of President Museveni and the rebel leader Joseph Kony towards you. Did any of them like you? Did any of them want to work with you? Or they both hated you? Or they both did not trust you? Which was which?
I had known President Museveni since 1990. When I was still in my early 20s, as president of the Students' Union, the Students' Guild of Makerere, I met him because we had a dispute and I had led a strike. So the channel of communication was open to President Museveni. Joseph Kony, by following my statements on radio, knew that I was one of the leading advocates for the human rights of my people and also for peace through dialogue. In 2003, Joseph Kony surprisingly gave me a telephone call and we spoke for close to 3 hours. He poured out his heart to me. Later, I rang President Museveni and went and briefed him. In a way, I became a bridge. I can't say they liked me, but I can say they knew that through me, they could talk to one another. So we got more support. And all these regional events, plus the changes around the world, pushed Yoweri Museveni and Joseph Kony to the negotiating table. And they started talks on July 14th, 2006.
Where was that?
In Juba.
Any outcome of those talks?
First, there was cessation of hostilities. The LRA completely vacated northern Uganda. That means the guns fell silent. What more could we ask for?
But talk to me about the how of transforming society from a war-torn society to one that is closer to normalcy. How did you work with the people to make sure that the rebuilding of their lives, the reconstruction process actually got underway, looking at central government on one hand, the ordinary people on the other, and then you as a local government on in the other corner?
The biggest challenge in reconstruction is reconstructing the minds of the war-affected communities. Mm-hmm. War makes you totally dependent on external actors. People who had been used for 20 years to lining up to receive food relief from World Food Program needed their minds readjusted so that they could go back to the land, work for themselves. The key was communication. I requested one of the major radio stations to give me 1 hour every week, and I had a radio program every Tuesday between 8 and 9 in the morning. I was basically preaching a sermon about what life could be if we come together, work hard. I had to talk about accepting the ex-combatants back in the communities. How do you accept someone who chopped off your father's head and see him walking, going to the stream, going to the market? And above all, how do you see him receiving a package of relief from the government? We preached forgiveness. We preached hard work. But above all, apart from communicating as a leader, I needed to stand shoulder to shoulder with other actors. NGOs had to come on board. The army had to come on board. This is the army that previously people were suspicious of. We had to tell the people that the army is our friend. And we had to tell the army that you should now leave the villages so that the police can go and take over. People had been used to seeing the army doing police work. So by communicating effectively a vision of a post-conflict society, and by working together with other key actors, we were able to bring the people to the level of thinking necessary for post-conflict reconstruction.
Talk to me about the mistakes you think you made or you might have made in your attempt to create change.
First of all, when you raise the expectations of people too much. For instance, I told the people we are going to make sure that we persuade the international community to give you conditional cash advances so that you take charge of your own reconstruction process at the micro level. None of the international organizations was willing even to hear about that. Secondly, I told the people we are going to go into an ambitious housing program. And I knew that for the equivalent of $1,200, it was possible by then to build a simple two-bedroom house. So I think I raised the expectations of the people too high. That is a mistake. Secondly, sometimes taking a very strong position. I think the very strong position I took on the ICC may have alienated some of our allies. We saw the International Criminal Court as a spoiler, because what we wanted most was peace, not five generals in the bush being taken to The Hague. And that caused some kind of misunderstanding. I think we should have articulated our position better to the ICC. We wanted our people to have an opportunity to lead a normal life. And a normal life was not possible if the bullets were still flying. The peace talks in Juba created the environment which has allowed the people to leave the camps and go back to their homes, start rebuilding their farms. It has allowed the local government, which I was leading for 5 years, to renovate schools, renovate hospitals, and rebuild the roads and the broken bridges. That would not have happened if the guns were still flying. A lot of businesses have opened their doors in Gulu and most of northern Uganda. Banks are very conservative. When banks like Barclays, Standard Chartered Bank, started opening branches in Gulu, I knew that finally we were going to start reaping the dividends of peace.